little pig pack goes in the danger zone. There's a rumbling ground down below. There's a big dark town. It's a place I've found. There's a world going on underground.
From the moment that I pocketed a disc that bore the fawn-legged girl's name and address, I was no longer an aspiring artist. I wanted to know what she knew, wanted to learn what she was learning. All was her name. A short, sweet name for a girl, and hard to forget, too. You can't forget a girl who wags her tail at you just like that anyway. And so she took me into the medical school and directed me to her own teacher. I became a member of the class immediately and discovered that I had entered upon the opening discourse. The class was dominated by the immense presence of the teacher, a son of the Titans, bearded and horned, expounding in the exact syllogism of the Technicon training. As he spoke, I became certain that this dynamo of human force should soon charge such a small battery as myself with everything in the way of knowledge I could assimilate. There was only one slight disturbing factor. Just as I had sensed a strange, deeply buried, and secret fear in the Sibyl, I knew that in the minds of this great son of the Titans there was a gnawing something that was a part of his brain, dwelt on continually. Fear was a smell that was ever in the nose down here in Tian City. The realization disturbed me so much that I failed to absorb a portion of the teacher's discourse. My absorption must have caught his attention too, for I saw him staring disapprovingly at me. With a start, I reconcentrated my mind on what he was saying. A great cold ball hung in space. Once it had been a mighty living planet, swinging ponderously around, a dying sun that it had never seen, being covered with clouds. Then that sun had gone out, and the deadly tear, the Lemurian word for cold, editor, stiffened the surface life into glittering death. The planet's forests, which had lived in dense, dripping fog, had in their many ages of life deposited coal beds untold miles in depth, clear down to the stony core of the planet. No fire had ever touched these forests, because the dense fog had never allowed fire to burn. Venus, our nearest neighbor in space, is such a planet now, although much smaller. As it is on Venus, so it was on the unknown planet. Hanging in space, the dead immensity of this ball was largely potential heat, for its tremendously thick shell was mostly pure carbon. Such once was the sun. Your sun and mine, the sun of which Mew is a daughter. Then a blazing meteor spewed violently from some sun in space, came flaming toward this cold ball. Deep it plunged into the beds of carbon. The fire spread swiftly, an ever fire of disintegrance, not the passing fire of combustion. And our sun was born into life-giving flame. A carbon fire is a clean fire, and contains no dense metals like radium, titanium, uranium, polonium, whose emanations in disintegrance in suns cause old age and death, because minute particles given off accumulate and convey the ever fire into the body, there to kill it in time. Then, sun heat was clean, and life sprang furiously into being on its daughter Mew's surface. Nor did this life die. Death came only by being eaten. Then life suffered old age not at all, for there was no cause. The voice of the teacher paused a moment, and now, indeed, I knew that there was much for me to learn. Here was something that struck deep into me with an instantly vital interest. Most provoking of all was his peculiar emphasis on the word then. I could not help the question that sprang to my lips. Why do you say then life suffered old age not at all, for there was no cause? Is there cause now? It was as though I had placed a torch beneath the hidden fear in the Titan's eyes, for it flamed forth suddenly for all to see, but it was as quickly quelled. All in the class looked at me with that shocked expression which plainly said I had overstepped my bounds. But in the eyes of Arl, I thought I saw the gleam of approval, and I found a dam to hold back my ebbing courage. The teacher looked at me, and I saw kindliness in his eye. You are new here, Mutant Mion. Therefore, it is easy to understand that you have not heard of the projected migration of all Atlans to a new world under a beneficial sun. Yes, young Ro, there is cause. He was answering my question with determination now, but he was not speaking to me alone. He was making his answer a part of his discourse. I have spoken of the carbon fire as a clean fire, By this I mean that the atoms of carbon, when disintegrated, send forth the beneficial energy ash called ext, which can be assimilated by our bodies and used to promote life growth. However, the source of this ash is not carbon alone, but all other elements excepting the heavy metals, such as I mentioned before. It is when these heavy elements begin to disintegrate in the Everfire that we come to the cause of age. The particles of radium and other radioactive metals are the poison that causes the aging of tissue. These particles are thrown out by all old suns whose shell of carbon has been partly or altogether burned away, permitting the disintegrating fire to reach and seize upon the heavy metals at the sun's core. Our sun has begun to throw out great masses of these poisonous particles. They fall upon Mu in a continual flood, entering into living tissue and infecting it with the radioactive disease we call age. Through the years, the centuries, these poisons accumulate in the soul of the planet and are continually being washed out of it by the rains, with the result that all the water on Mu is becoming increasingly contaminated. When these waters are drunk, the poisons accumulate in the body, finally becoming numerous enough to completely halt all growth, and still worse, to prevent any effectual use of ext, which is the food of all integration. The Technicons, of course, have devised means to protect us from the accumulation of the age poisons, but it has become evident that their efforts are not entirely foolproof. We have discovered that we are living on a world that circles a sun that is growing old, and is therefore deadly. We are living in the shadow of death, a shadow that will grow greater as the years pass until finally death will strike us all. We would, if we remained, not even begin to live out our lives. Centuries and centuries would be lost to us, and ultimately we might not even attain the initial growth of maturity. I venture another question. What methods have the Technicons devised? They are simple ones. Multiple distillation of the water in which we drink and bathe, treatment of the water in a centrifuge to remove the very finely divided age poisons that cannot be removed by distillation, Ben generators to create a magnetic field of Ben energies, air centrifuges to remove poisons from the air. But I must impress upon you that it is impossible to shield us from all of the age poison. From that small amount that actually falls upon our own bodies and accumulates there, as it does in the water. Eventually, if we remain on Mu, we will grow old. Impressed with the implications contained in this portion of the story of Mutant Mion, we wrote Mr. Shaver for additional information on this theory of the cause of age. This information is curious because some of the theories seem to be modern, by Mr. Shaver, and others those of Mutant Mion, with no particular designation as to which is which. However, we present the whole for your judgment. The sun itself seems to be the mother source of all radioactivity, infecting all the Earth's surface and all the life on its surface. The sun projects minute disintegrances down upon us in a steady, numerous rain, whose effects we call age. In water, the poison is heavily present in suspension, especially so in thermal springs. In the air, the poison floats forever with the tiny thistle downs of dust it is infected and to which it clings. It settles on the leaves of plants, so we take the poison in with every breath, with every bite of food, with every drink of water. Thus we age, as the poison accumulates. But we do not have to let in that poison. We can protect ourselves and grow through a longer youth to a much greater age, with superior mental powers. It is very plain that a mother's body cells, although replaced every 4 to 7 years, are not young, because they remain in contact with the poison retaining fabric of the body, and so age swiftly. Yet the baby is young. Young because it gets filtered blood filtered through the placenta, and would remain young if the poisons were to be continued to be filtered out by a duplication of the placenta filter. The stalk of a plant is old, yet its seed is young, capable of reproducing itself without passing on the poisons of age. It is because the stalk contains a filter to prevent passage of the poison to the seed. The simple filtration processes of birth and seeding can be copied by man, thus putting off old age. Here are a few verbatim quotations from Madame Curie's notes. Finally, the radiation of radium was contagious. Contagious like a disease and like persistent scent, it is impossible for an object, a plant, an animal, or a person to be left near a table of radium without it immediately acquiring radioactivity, becoming radioactive, a notable activity which a sensitive apparatus could detect. A later page. Thus the radio elements formed strange and cruel families, in which each member is created by degeneration from the mother substance. Radium was created by degeneration from uranium, polonium from radium, etc. And from a later page. When one studies strongly radioactive substances, special precautions must be taken if one wishes to be able to take delicate measurements. The various objects used in a chemical laboratory and those used in physics experiments all become radioactive in a short time and affect photopaper through black paper. Dust, the air of the room, one's clothes all become radioactive. The evil has reached an acute stage in our laboratory. Note the word mother. The sun is the mother source of radioactives. It is a matter of common knowledge that certain watch factories formerly allowed workers, young girls of 20, to tongue-tip the brushes with which they painted the radioactive dials. They died of old age at 20 and 25 years, not of a disease, but of age poison. Radioactive particles, whose origination is from the disintegration of the heavy metals of which radium is a member. Editor. And finally die. I looked him squarely in the eyes, respectful in a degree equal to the kindly interest that shone in his as he returned my look. It is not the age poisons you fear, I accused. He looked at me silently, and a flood of force seemed to flow through me, encouraging me, protecting me, cautioning me. It was the same feeling I had gotten from the Sibyl. Come, students, he said gently, we will go now to the embryo laboratory. Before we entered the laboratory, we were given nutrient potions, prescribed by the Titan for his students to make them more receptive and hence his work easier. We were told that we would receive these potions regularly. Even as I took the first draft, my brain throbbed with a new growth of ideas and strange new images. I was exhilarated beyond all imagining, and my enthusiasm knew no bounds. I took Al's hand in mine as we trooped into the laboratory. It was truly a wonderful place, the most amazing I had ever seen. I felt like a mite admitted to the treasure house of a giant. Here were things that were beyond my intelligence to create of my own mind power, and yet I was being given free and welcome access to all of them, to learn from them and to use the knowledge if I wished in my future life and work. Many strange machines filled the laboratory, all performing tasks that I could only guess at. But these machines were subordinate to the real science of this great room, being designed only to chemically and electronically nourish and develop the many human embryos that moved and grew in synthetically duplicated mother blood in sealed bottles. The elder ones kicked and tugged healthily at the grafted umbilical tube which supplied the life fluid, called ichor, the blood of the gods. And it was this blood that was the subject of the lecture the Titan now gave us. He told us of the upkeep and preparation of this fluid, both in the embryo and the adult, the difficult and important part being, he now stressed his words with greater emphasis and his attention bent especially toward me. The process of detecting and removing the slightest trace of the radioactive poisons that cause age. I studied and I learned. These were the processes which had given the planet Mu its health and enabled us to live under more aging suns than other races. These were the life methods that had given us our fecundity, which had populated space for thousands of centuries with the seed of Atlan. I wanted to know all there was to learn about them. The Titan, an old master at this most basic process of Atlan life, had imbued me with an enthusiasm for the true creation of life in its infinite possibilities of growth, such as no mere painter ever had. The delicate handling of those ultra-minute products of disintegrants from which primary integrations are formed, the mixing of these integrations into the atoms of elements, the chemistry of combining these atoms into the molecules of the substances used in the manufacture of the synthetic blood ichor. All these steps were sheer artistry, yet were made as simple as child thought by the genius of the Titan. Once more, the Titan commented on the proposed emigration from Mu, weaving it into his lecture. There seemed to me to be an undercurrent of double meaning in his motive for repeating it, a double meaning that I strove to and succeeded associate mentally with the fear thing that was something else. And also something so secret it must not be mentioned. It was as though even the fact that there was fear of that something must be kept secret. Our aging sun, he said, threw off increasingly large amounts of these sun's seeds, small but dense and active disintegrative particles, and I learned that keeping Atlan's peoples young was an increasingly difficult job for the Technicons. I learned that the coordinators and Rhodite, life pattern synchronizers, editor, were preparing the plans and ships for our migration to a young newborn sun, where the forced setup of life conditions left a greater margin of ext for intake of power, where integrants went on at a faster pace, and where the infection that caused the occasional trouble with detrimental energy robotism, or detrimental air. This is mainly due, explains Mr. Shaver, to depolarization of the matter of the brain. It is no longer earth-polared, it is sun-polared, and hence inducts the disintegrant flows from the sun into the brain by simple dynamic induction. I think a magnet could be sun-polared and point to the poles of the sun, just as an ordinary compass points to the poles of the Earth. This is what happens to parts of the brain. They become sun-polared. In the desert, this is known as cafard, to become crazed and kill until killed. Others are just stupid, depending on what parts of the brain are affected. The Malay Amok and the Norse Berserk are the same phenomena. When it lies in the part of the brain devoted to memory, the result is absent-mindedness. When it lies in the nervous system and ego recognition or activating centers, the victim is a killer or a repressive reactionary. It is simply true that man is an electrical machine, which functions well when his energy flows are of his own creating, but functions especially ill when the energy flows are from the sun. The sun is quite a dynamo. It always gives off from the surface, while Earth always takes in from the surface. Much of this intake is snapback, that is, it is returning to a state of matter. Gravity is merely the disintegrant energy of suns returning to material form. Much of it, however, is like radium, a persistent disintegrant seed of a sun. Radioactivity is the seed of disintegration. Hence, a mind powered by sun particle energy flows of a detrimental nature becomes robot. The result is robotism, or the inability to think constructively. Victims of detrimental air have but one basic thought, to kill, in keeping with the natural elemental instinct of the disintegrant metals. The reader has been presented here with two sensational theories, which appear in complete form later in the manuscript, the nature of gravity and the interrelation of energy and matter in an endless circle. Editor. In the human did not occur. When the lecture in the embryo laboratory was finished, we filed back to the classroom, and there the Titan flipped the switch that controlled the tele-eyes that supplied the home telesets of many with the course. We had not been dismissed, and I could see from the puzzled looks on the faces of the other students that this was not in accordance with the regular schedule. For a long moment, the Titan looked at us, and especially at me. Then he spoke. Today things have been said and seen and discussed in this class that had no direct bearing on the course you came here to take. You, Mutan Mayon, have been the most brash. My face grew red and he hastened to add, No, Mutan, I do not mean that you have been too forward. I meant brash in the sense that you have exposed yourself to a greater danger than that of my wrath. His eyes twinkled at the word wrath, and I knew that such would never be much of a danger. I meant the menace that has caused the fear you have somehow seen in me. Perhaps you have sensed this in other places in Tian City, among others of the Titans, so it must be, for you to have been so certain of it as to challenge me. Yes, there was, and is fear in me. And it is a fear that we all try to keep secret, because those of us who show fear also show suspicion, if not knowledge, and neither has been equivalent to the signing of a death warrant. There are spying rays on us, at the moment we are screened, that seek out our knowledge and destroy us before we can coordinate it into an effective counteraction to the thing that is going on, to the thing we fear. What is the thing? I breathed aloud, so intense was my interest. The Titan drew a deep breath. It has come to me that certain groups of Atlan are against the projected migration, and the recent disappearance of several men important to our work lends color to the story. Of course, we all know that the only units able to do anything of the kind would be the Kirodite of Sub-Atlan and Center Mu. Some of these may have accidentally suffered a severe flashback of detrimental ion flow, so that their will has become one under detrimental hypnosis. What Rodite area has become so corrupted as to allow such a condition to go unchecked, I cannot understand. But that we are all in danger until the thing is checked is most certainly true. Therefore, since you here have gained an inkling of something wrong, it is only your right to be aware of it, so that inadvertent words may not cause you great harm. Also, we must fight this thing, and all of us must fight. So you may consider yourselves deputized by the ruling life of Mu to seek out the information that will clear the way for the migration. Until that is done, we suffer fear, not new to me, but new to most of you. You may go. Looking back at his gigantic form as I left the classroom, I saw him musing deeply, and the concern on his face told me that things must be even more fearful of consequence than he had made us believe. Reason told me, too, that it must be so, for great indeed must be the evil that can bring fear to the heart of a titan, the super being of all Mu and of the universe.
There's a world going on underground.
As always, thanks to all of my amazing Patreon supporters, particularly Michael Fittori, Xanazira, Brake System BSE, and Zachary Snowden Smith, for making this video possible. And once again, I would like to draw your attention to another channel called I Will Say This Though, where we will have a new video up probably within the next week or so, where we'll be ranking Pixar movies based on how well they fit Umberto Eco's definition of fascism. You don't want to miss that. That's going to be great. And I'll put a link to that in the video description. So in the meantime, thanks for watching this one, and thanks for being you.